We think it's San Salvador. Yeah. There are six or seven islands, but that's the one that's usually considered the first
landfall. And the Indian tribe that you mentioned earlier.
The Taino.
The Taina?
Yeah, Taino.
Taino.
Yes.
He likes them. They are friendly to him.
Right,
and he gives them beads and bells, and all he wants is the gold that's in their nose. Well,
that's right. They wore very striking gold jewelry, some of which is preserved in museums, and people can see it or they can find it online. And he assumed, because he looked at things in a very biblical, kind of literal-minded way, that King Solomon's mines must be around here somewhere. He had been inspired by Marco Polo, as you probably know, and he seemed to forget that had all happened 200 years before, and he was nowhere near China and the Mongol Empire, where Marco Polo had been an important person for a while, was long gone, and he expected to find many of the same things that Marco Polo wrote about, especially the gold. How do we know this? Because Columbus actually brought a copy of Marco Polo's travels with him and underlined the things he wanted to find, almost like a shopping list, and made marginal notes. But the only kind of gold they really found, and they were basically around the island of Cuba and Hispaniola, which is where the Dominican Republic is gold that washed down hillsides. So they found some gold nuggets, which whetted his appetite for more, but never that motherlode.
In that voyage, his Santa Maria is having problems.
Right.
He takes it apart in order to build a fort,
right,
so it doesn't look like he is a failure. Now, there was one other captain, the...
Pinzon.
Talk about them, because
sure,
they were two brothers.
Sure. They were two brothers. Columbus on that first voyage was a neophyte. He was an experienced navigator. He had sailed to Greece and he had sailed to Iceland. But this was all a new adventure, and you have to admire the astounding courage of all these people to sail off into the unknown, to be the first people to ever come back from the Caribbean or the New World or China, wherever they thought they were going, and to do it four times, not just once. But he needed the backing of the local sailing experts, and these were the two Pinzon brothers. But one of them seemed to kind of become mentally unstable, to lose his marbles along the way, began to disobey Columbus. It looked like there was a mutiny in progress. His ship became wrecked, and Columbus was concerned because they were Spanish, and therefore they had higher social standing in Spain than he did as an expatriate Genoese sailor. Don Columbus or not, the Spanish still had, they lorded it over him, if you will. And so this was a major problem for a while. Once he got back to Spain, it turned out that the Pinzon, who had gone astray, really had lost his marbles and died shortly thereafter. So the threat that they posed went away, but it looked like he was going to lose control of that first voyage, just at the critical moment. Instead, he did get briefly, if not a hero's welcome, then a very, very warm reception by Ferdinand and Isabella, partly because he had exaggerated the extent of his discovery. First of all, he claimed he had gone to China, and he hadn't. He had gone to the Caribbean. Secondly, he said, well, if we found this amount of spices and this amount of gold, there must be much, much more. This is just the beginning. And as you mentioned, he used some of the timber from this shipwreck to build a small fort, and he left a handful of Spanish soldiers behind in the Dominican Republic. It was a nucleus, it depends how you look at it. From one direction, it could be considered the nucleus of the first Spanish colony in the New World. On the other hand, you could say, well, he left them behind as hostages and created a hostage situation where he had to go back and free them as soon as possible. And that's exactly what happened. Once he told Ferdinand and Isabella and their ministers about this, within a few months, he was back on the water, heading back to the New World.
And he never saw an island that he didn't want to put the Spanish flag on.
Right. Yeah. He never saw an island and he landed on so many, dozens and dozens. It's hard to know exactly which ones because over 500 years the topography has shifted, and he sometimes obscured his tracks the way many sailors did at that time, so that he couldn't be... other sailors couldn't come along and, you know, have a copycat mission and steal his thunder, although that happened anyway. His base of operations became the island of Hispaniola, the Dominican Republic. In fact, the first city that he founded, Santo Domingo in 1503, is the oldest European settlement in the New World, the oldest continuously inhabited European settlement. And if you go there now, you see it looks like a piece of old Spain. This has somehow traveled through a time machine and landed there. So that was his base of operations. But over these four voyages, Connie, he went as far south as almost the northern tip of Brazil, and as far north, now he never got to North America, as you probably know. It sounds incredible, but the closest approach was seeing the Florida Keys from the deck of one of his ships. I think that was on the first voyage, and then he decided it was getting a little chilly, and he headed south. And he never even guessed at the existence of North America. So this entire country, which in some extent, you know, carries its name all over the place, and countless landmarks, and the District of Columbia, and on and on and on, he would have been astounded by this country that, you know, had took his name, and whose existence he never guessed. And as I mentioned over and over, he was looking for China.
And he should have been called Cuba.
Yes.
Yeah. Because that was the big landmass that he was sure had to be China.
Right. One of the things that really gives the an impression of how unusual Columbus's thinking was that when they got to Cuba, the Indians, the Taino who were there, said, this is a long island. This is a very big island. If you sail far enough west, you will come to the end of it. Now, we think of Columbus as a modern, perhaps the first modern explorer, more methodical and more scientific than other explorers, which was the secret of his success. But it didn't seem to me that way in writing the book. He refused to go. He didn't want to find out that Cuba was an island, and he preferred to maintain that it was a peninsula, that it was a promontory of Asia. His idea of the Earth did not include the Pacific Ocean. You can subtract that. So he thought he could have arrived at some promontory of Asia, and that's what he promised Ferdinand and Isabella. If he was wrong about that, then all his underlying assumptions about this voyage were wrong, which of course they were. He didn't want to admit the possibility, so he actually made all the sailors, even the cabin boys who went along, sign an oath that Cuba was part of the Asian mainland,